Well, the Grand Renaissance Dam is a dam under construction on the Blue Nile River. It is basically one of our largest or biggest water source. That means it has a lot of hydro potential because of Ethiopia has this advantage of the head and discharge flowing and or contributing to the Nile, and while it passes through the highland Ethiopia and the west part to the lowlands of Sudan, it passes through significant elevation difference. As a result, possesses a lot of hydro potential. So the current location is the ideal location where all the tributaries are actually into the river, and just 20 kilometers away from the Sudan border. So that is the optimal location. In fact, this location is also identified long time ago by US Bureau of Reclamation. So that means it's an ideal location. There are other locations upstream, but not possessing that much higher potential of energy. So that is one. Why we build a dam? Dam is needed in Ethiopian hydrologic condition. When you look at the rainfall pattern, it is unimodal, happening between mid-June up to end of October. The biggest flow passes through the river during this period. So if you want to do meaningful development, be it for hydro or for irrigation development or drinking water supply, you have to regulate the water. That means you have to distribute the very high peak flow during these 3 months into throughout the year type of flow. So the dam site is an ideal site where every river tributary is ended up into the river. It's an ideal site because you bring together the Q and H at that particular location, and it distributes the water throughout the year. Yes, the dam of this magnitude, of course, is complex in terms of the technicality. And for example, at the very initial stage, when we opened up the foundation, it was a difficult one. We have to actually dig deep into the foundation until we found sound rock. That took a significant period of time. That's, for example, one situation which we didn't anticipate. Because when you do the physical survey and the pre-dam construction type of survey, you don't really see exactly what the foundation looks like, but you can anticipate based on a geophysical type of survey. But when you open the foundation, when you actually open, you get some surprises. Therefore, you have to really drill and dig deep and excavate until you reach the base rock. So that is one complexity, for example. We had also very good ambition in terms of building our own national capacity in order to really do some of the electromechanical and the steel work. Although that intention was very good, it wasn't that much successful also. So we have to replace and bring more experience at contractor in terms of civil, not civil work, but on steel structures. So at the current situation, the contractors are, for example, for turbine installation, are the manufacturers themselves, like General Electric or Voith Hydro from Germany. General Electric, is from US. The turbines they have manufactured, they install by themselves. On the steel structure work, we employed other subcontractors who have experience in Ethiopia, who have built Gibe III dam, similar type of steel structure. So on the concrete part, Salini, Pierre Joy is doing, all these are making the dam to be constructed in a quality way. So the challenge, however, was, you know, the initial assumption of the local contractor coordinates all this was not that much successful, therefore it has to be adjusted. Well, the Nile waters, you can see it in a different context. One, from the context of the dam, just the Grand Ethiopia Renaissance Dam. The other one is a broader framework where we have been negotiating for years with riparian countries, upstream and downstream countries. So on the broader framework, we have created what we call comprehensive framework agreement, which has got about 45 articles. In those articles, you know, all countries, including Egypt and Sudan, were working together in the framework of Nile Basin Initiative. But at the last moment, Sudan and Egypt actually pulled out of those comprehensive framework agreement, and other six riparian countries have signed. Four have already ratified this comprehensive framework agreement. This will lead ultimately to what we call Nile Basin Commission. It will be the future of the Nile, actually. I'm sure downstream countries ultimately will come to it, because in natural discourse of this kind of river basin commission, it's in fact the downstream country who want to protect themselves from the upstream countries who look for this kind of framework agreement, not the other way around. But here it is the other way around. That is one context. So in future, definitely that is the way to go. But in terms of Grand Renaissance Dam, it is just a project. It's a hydro project. A hydro project is non-consumptive. It stores water, as I've said at the beginning. It will distribute the hydrologies in equitable ways throughout the year, throughout the 12 months. That's the only variation it brings. Otherwise, since the dam is storing water, it becomes like a water bank, protecting against flood downstream, releases regulated flow, in fact helps the socio-economic situation in the downstream countries by uplifting energy, for example, where the turbines that are served by small dams in the downstream will be having higher efficiency because they have bigger dam upstream and regulated flow. It means they can work on higher plant factor. All these are advantages, but for Ethiopia, it is really a significant source of energy to develop Ethiopia's socio-economy. The current energy capacity is very low. We have about 4,400 megawatt. The Grand Renaissance Dam will bring about 150% of the currently available energy. So it will really help to boost the economy and supply the needed energy into the Ethiopian economy for manufacturing, industrialization, agro-processing, service sector growth, in tourism, what have you. But also in regional energy, it will bring a lot of value. First of all, it is relatively cheaper electricity. We have already connection to Sudan and Djibouti. We can increase the capacity to those countries. With Kenya, we are already constructing a big transmission highway, which will ultimately can transmit up to 2,000 megawatt, which will start with 400 megawatt in 2020. Those kind of regional infrastructure benefits from the Ethiopia's hydro. The big benefit is when you take other renewable energies that are intermittent, let's say solar or wind. Solar, you don't have it in the night. When you have hydro combined in the East Africa power pool, for example, the hydro can be put on and off in a matter of minutes. That means when the solar is out, then hydro can be substituted and increase the integrated energy system in the region. The same with wind. Therefore, you know, the hydro development in Ethiopia, rivers that have got the head and discharge advantage, will be very, very beneficial for East Africa Power Pool, ultimately also for Africa Power Pool. The design is in such a way that, you know, it starts generating in 2020, that means in the ninth year, not really ninth or eighth year. That means early generation with two turbines will commence next year, end of next year, or beginning of 2020, or beginning of 2021 is the latest. So we're going to store the first stage this coming rainy season in July, August, and start operating the two turbines in the beginning of next year. And that is then after we take additional 2 years to complete the project by 2022. That is 10, 11 years. So the dam of this magnitude and capacity is usually complex, as we have discussed earlier. It takes such a long period of time. In terms of the filling, it takes 4 to 7 years. You know, we follow adaptive and cooperative principle. Adaptive in a sense, when you have a lot of water, it's potentially flooding downstream, we capture a lot. When it is very dry, extreme dry condition, also we pass the water. Instead of storing where it is normal, we have a certain magnitude of water to be controlled. Therefore, the range will be between 4 to 7 years.